Sid Roth here. Welcome to my world, where it's naturally supernatural. Last week, we found out about these amazing prophecies buried in the Vatican. 900 years ago, what would happen to each pope all the way up to the last pope. On this show, we're going to continue, and we're going to talk about the Vatican's secret plans for welcoming an alien god with a small g under the reign of the last pope. Well, last week we talked about the Saint Malachi. And Chris, I have to ask you, does the Pope know about these prophecies? Do the cardinals know about these prophecies? What do they think of them?
Well, Sid, there's actually a lot of evidence that they do take it very seriously. In fact, Pope Pius XII, who was the Pope during World War II, he actually produced a documentary film about himself, and the title of the film is the Malachi motto for his papacy, Angelic Shepherd. He actually titled the film after the Malachi prophecy's prediction for him. So he not only endorsed it, he claimed it.
Okay, Tom, as just a short review, what, based on the prophecies out of the Vatican that were hidden for all these generations, are they anticipating with the final pope?
Well, the idea among both Catholics and Protestant scholars is that he will be the final pope. He is the one who is going to be residing over the Vatican as it enters into the Great Tribulation period. And there's also the belief among even some of the Catholic mystics that he might be a false pope, an anti-pope, somebody who helps give rise to the Antichrist.
Let me tell you something. Judaism, Christianity, and other religions have focused on the year 2012. You know, remember the Mayan prediction, the end of the world in 2012? So everyone's discounted all of that, but that's not exactly what the prediction said. What did it say?
In the conferences where I spoke last year, I kept telling people, don't say it's the end of the world. That's not what the Maya said. That's not what the Aztecs said. That's not what the Cherokee Indians said, all of whose calendar rolled over at the end of 2012. What was it that they were saying? They were saying 2012 was the end of an era, and 2013 marks a new dispensation. Now, the Maya said some things that were very interesting. They said it would be marked by the emergence of two great male figures who would emerge upon the earth. They sound very much like they're talking about the false prophet, right, and the Antichrist. They talked about their god Bolion Yakteku, the spirit of it, coming up from out of the underworld. Now, what does this god do? He guards the bones and the seed of the giants that are in the underworld, and that spirit would begin to rise in the year 2013, giving birth even to a new form of humanity.
You're talking about what I've read about and pondered so many times in the Bible. Maybe you've read this about the Nephilim, where the sons of God cohabited with the daughters of humans and produced great giants. That's what it sounds like.
That's exactly what I'm talking about. And furthermore, turn of the century preachers, including Jonathan Edwards, marked the year 2012 to 2016 as the date when the false prophet and the Antichrist would appear. Dozens of Protestant reformers marked these years hundreds of years ago. Not only that, and you appreciate this with your Jewish ministries, the Zohar, one of the most important books of Jewish Kabbalah ever written.
It is accepted in traditional Judaism as coming from God. It's not all from God, I can tell you as a fact, but it's an interesting situation that it talks about.
In a section of the Zohar called Signs Heralding Mashiach, the coming of the Messiah, they marked the year 5773, which in the Jewish calendar began in September 2012, and comes through into this year, 2013, and said that was the time. In fact, much of the prophecy sounds almost identical to the prophecy of the popes. It is a time that will lead to the destruction of Rome, and more importantly, they said, at that time, Messiah will begin making himself known to the nations of the world. This 700 years ago prophesied that between 2012 to 2013, the emergence of the Messiah would appear on earth, almost an identical parallel to cultures around the world that for thousands of years saw these dates specifically as the time when the end times would begin.
Speaking of end times, many of you are familiar with the apparitions of Mary and Fatima and people going there and being healed, but it's not exactly the way we've been told, is it, Chris?
No, it's not. What would happen if there was a massive UFO sighting? Well, what happened in Fatima, Portugal in 1917 was really just that, in my opinion. Now, up to 70,000 people gathered in a field, supposedly to see an apparition of the Virgin Mary. But if you go and read the descriptions of what people call the miracle of the sun, they actually describe seeing a gray, silvery disc rotating around in the sky and kind of putting a cascade of colors, like a rainbow of colors. And so it really, in 1917, no one had vocabulary of words like flying saucer.
Right.
But that's exactly what it sounds like they're describing to me.
Yeah, I've always thought Mary just appeared in the sky.
It really wasn't Mary at all. They're talking about a sphere or a silver disc.
And that same flying saucer, let's call it for what it is, demonic, according to my notes here, in 1950, Pope Pius XII saw the same thing. Explain.
Well, what's interesting about the Marian dogmas, all these things that we don't see in the Bible, is that the theology has sort of escalated over time. Now, in 1950, Pope Pius saw a sphere over the Vatican Gardens, the same sort of thing that you hear about at Fatima. Now, this sighting of this opaque sphere, flying saucer, you know, UFO, inspired him to define a new doctrine that all Catholics have to believe, and that is that Mary ascended into heaven just like Jesus does in Acts chapter 1.
Wait till you find their research of what the Vatican is ready to announce in reference to end time Bible prophecy and in reference to aliens coming to planet Earth. We'll be right back. As far as I'm concerned, I'm being blown out of the water. And a lot of my end time thinking is the whole paradigm is changing in light of the Bible prophecy that you're bringing to us. Tell me about the Vatican Conference of a gathering of scientists to discuss extraterrestrial activity.
Certainly. In 2009, the Vatican sponsored an astrobiology conference.
And now, that means?
That is the study of life in space. Now, what makes that interesting is that we don't really know of any life in space, yet our universities have, you know, programs where you can study this. They had the top secular scientists in the world come to Rome for this conference in 2009. We're talking about, you know, atheists, you know, secular scientists, and the sort of topics that they're covering, things like shadow life, exoplanets.
What's an exoplanet?
An exoplanet is a planet that's outside of our solar system.
Okay.
So you have the top scientists in the world gathering in Rome for the Pontifical Academy of Sciences, an audience of for the Pope to study life in space.
Speaking of studying life in space, how about life on Earth? Tom, tell me about the hybrid humans.
This is one of the things that I didn't even expect would arrive in our study. There is academics who actually believe that there is a hybridity program that is going on right now. And this took me on a kind of a long journey that brought me back to one question, Sid, and that is why in ancient days when the giants, the first original hybrid humans, right, when they were created by fallen angels and were upon the earth, what was their mission, what was their program? It also had to do with hybridity, and it also had to do with misleading and misguiding and even challenging God himself. But notice that the oldest descriptions of those giants, how tall they were, 20 feet, 30 feet, they would be easy to pick up, right? There's a movie out there right now, Jack the Giant Slayer, and it's kind of based on that mythos that exists in every culture around the world. They tell the story, the gods came down, the gods mingled themselves with humans. They took human genetics, animal genetics. They created a hybrid body. Now the question is, down through time, You know, the Bible tells us there were giants in those days and also after that. So now we get past the flood and you have the Og, the king of Bashan. What is he, 12 feet tall? He's certainly not 20 or 30. And it looks to me like there was an intentional breeding down in size of the of these hybrid humans until today they could possibly be walking among us and we might not even know that we see them. There are academics who actually believe now that they are walking among us, that they're even in government. Now, that sounds astonishing. It sounds like a sci-fi movie, right?
It does. In fact, why is Hollywood glamorizing all these things at the same time?
Well, that's exactly right. So is that part of a setup? Are there occultists in Hollywood that have an agenda to try to help prepare humanity for what could be a kind of great deception?
Genesis 6:9 talks about Noah. Explain that.
Our research led us to believe that something that happened in ancient days could be occurring even now as we speak. And when I say ancient days, I'm talking about the days of Noah, a time when all of the ancient records from around the world tell us that very powerful angels came down and they mingled with humans and with animals.
The best record is the Bible. The Nephilim is what he's talking about. Go ahead.
Absolutely, the Nephilim. And it was a period of time in which only Noah, and therefore by extension his children, mm-hmm. were found, according to the Old Testament, perfect. When you study why the great flood came, the scripture makes it very clear that it happened because all flesh, both man and beast, had been corrupted. So something was happening in ancient days that had to do with the genetic degradation of God's creation.
What does it mean when it says in the Torah about Noah that he was perfect?
Yes, this is the Hebrew word temyem. Means it's the same phrase that's used to describe an unblemished sacrificial lamb. It's talking about genetics. It's talking about his DNA had not been corrupted, as evidently the rest of the world had been by that time. So there was a saturation, an intermarriage between angels and humans, and then through intermarriage this was spreading over hundreds of years until finally, by the time we reach Noah, he's the last specimen left that has a genetic makeup, his DNA, as God had made it. And therefore, you understand why God has to send this flood to wipe out all of this contaminated forms of life and sent this judgment in the days of Noah. Now, Jesus says, as it was in the days of Noah.
Oh, yes. Tell me this. In the parable of the wheat and the tares, the wheat and the weeds, the Messiah said, let them grow up together. Don't pull them out. I'm wondering if that's the difference between those whose DNA has not been corrupted and those whose DNA has been corrupted, perhaps through a hybridization process of these aliens. What do you think?
You know, Sid, behind the scenes right now, this question is unfolding among academics in a way that you can't even possibly imagine, where they're asking the question, have we concluded that hybrids are among us? And if hybrids are among us, can they even be saved? This is a complex question that's being raised by theologians right now. Isn't that an astonishing thing?
What's even more astonishing to me is the Vatican secret plan for welcoming in an alien god with a small g. We'll be right back. I'll tell you what, very few Christians, Protestants, or Catholics understand what you're about ready to understand right now. But there are secret plans for welcoming. The Vatican will welcome in this alien from another planet as God. Tell me about that.
Well, Sid, you know, when you look at Bible prophecy and it talks about a one world government and a one world religion, mm-hmm. you know, you see how divided the world still is. And, you know, we have to think that something unprecedented is going to occur that would unite the world under one heading like that. Now, Ronald Reagan gave a speech to the United Nations where he said how quickly our differences would be resolved if we were faced with an alien threat from outside this world. I mean, this is in the 80s. He gave this speech in the UN. Now, if you look around the world, what people believe, I mean, statistics in the United States say around 50% of Americans already think that UFOs are aliens visiting the Earth. Now, there was a recent poll in the United Kingdom. More people believe in extraterrestrials in the UK than God. okay? And that's a fact. And so to me, the strong delusion is already here. The groundwork has been laid. And in our hypothesis is these powers and principalities that Paul writes about in Ephesians 6, these demonic forces have seeded this idea into the world, so we are primed and ready for a deception.
Okay, but what makes you think the Vatican has planned to announce this?
Well, you know, they're having astrobiology conferences. They've made it intellectually virtuous to believe in these extraterrestrials. Their writings coming out of their theologians have pretty much made the argument that if you don't believe in extraterrestrials, then that is actually the heresy.
You talk about that the Vatican is going to reevaluate their position on basic Christianity. What do you mean by that?
Well, their theologians have written that they think that these entities will be evangelizing us, that they think the chances are that they're not fallen and we are, so that we would have to modify our beliefs according to their revelation.
So are they talking about setting up teams to evangelize humans and aliens? Is that what you're really talking about?
Well, if you get on the internet right now, you'll find
And baptize them?
Hundreds of articles from the Vatican astronomers talking about baptizing extraterrestrials.
100 years ago, our top wonderful theologians had predictions based on their study of Scripture. Tell me about Hawkins Pember that wrote about the days of Noah 100 years ago.
George Hawkins Pember was writing in the 19th century, and he found parallels between what he saw in the days of Noah and his age. And, you know, he pulled out 7 parallels, and there were things like the church marrying itself to the world. Well, and I went through his list and then compared it to where we are now. Now, everything that he saw in the 19th century has just, you know, exponentially grown. I mean, you look at like the church married to the world. Now we have mainline denominations ordaining homosexual clergy and putting them up as their leadership.
But they saw this 100 years ago. It was coming.
He did. And the 7th thing on his list was actually the appearance of these entities. And he called them from the prince of the power of the air, which is what Paul calls Satan in Ephesians chapter 2. Now, the demonic realm in the New Testament worldview was the atmosphere above the earth.
Now, tell me a couple other points that he saw.
Well, Pember saw a vast population increase, for one. Now, our population has grown by leaps and bounds since something he couldn't even imagine. He saw a confusion of gender roles. Hmm. He was talking about it in the 19th
century.
Does that
sound familiar to you? It sounds familiar to me.
I don't think he would even have any, you know, inkling of how far that's gone now. I mean, now we have transsexuals, we have, you know, homosexual marriages.
What did he say about holiness?
He saw that there was an emphasis on God being benevolent to the extent that they denied his holiness. Now, I think that we see this in this idea of pluralism, which is so popular in our culture, where all religions point to the same God. And this is a really acceptable notion in today's society. Like, to talk about hell or eternal punishment or the exclusivity of our Messiah, Yeshua, is the thing that most people don't tolerate.
But you see, all these things the Bible says is black and white. They've got to be watered down for there to be a one-world religion, for people to welcome in an Antichrist. I mean, what a setup. Even one of the things that he prophesied that you just brought up is a lack of holiness, a lack in belief that there is a hell, a lack in belief that there's even a devil. And you know, some of these things are surfacing right now.
Absolutely. I mean, I even quoted some of the Catholic theologians at Notre Dame who deny that Satan is a real personal power. I mean, they just see him as some sort of abstraction or metaphor for evil.
I want you to tell me the strongest thing in all of your research, and you've done both of you, you've done extensive research. I want each of you to tell me the strongest thing you found in your research.
Well, as I'm listening right now to you and Chris talking, the strongest thing that's in my mind is what, what Vatican experts have told us. When Father Malachi Martin was asked, why is the Vatican, why do they have a presence on Mount Graham? And one of the things we haven't had time to talk about is Mount Graham is sacred to the Apache. It is a stargate through which they've, for centuries, have seen creatures that come, that move back and forth.
Now, this is right in Arizona.
This is in Arizona. And in fact, their creation mythos is that a disc came down and a bearded guy in the disc, who was the father of creation, was what established Mount Graham as a holy mountain. Well, anyway, when Malachi Martin was asked, why is the Vatican on Mount Graham? What are they doing up there? He said that they're using their telescope to watch something. And when he was pressed on the question, he said it's because at the highest levels of the Vatican governance, they know what is approaching the earth, and it will be of the utmost importance in coming years. They're literally watching something with the Lucifer device that is approaching planet Earth.
And what do you believe they're looking for?
I think that they could be deceived. I think they're watching something and they think it's one thing and I think it's something else. Lucifer, I think it's Satan. I think Jesus said, I beheld Satan as lightning falling from heaven. He has to do with the power of the air. And of course, you know, when Pope Benedict stepped down not long ago, twice lightning struck the top of the St. Peter's Basilica. And this goes back to their belief system. In Romanism, the belief was that the God would tell you when somebody should step down and when a new king should be elected. It was called augurism, and it's where we take the word inaugural or inauguralism for the placement of a new king.
I'll tell you what, as the kids say, you're blowing my mind, but you've got to make Jesus your Lord. Believe he forgave you of your sins. Believe he's your Lord. Welcome him inside now.
Why does the Vatican own an...
I'm interrupting this telecast with a special announcement. We have a new pope, St. Francis. According to the Malachi prophecy, he had to be a Roman. Did you know that this new pope's parents were from Italy, Roman? Not only that, he's the first Jesuit to ever be pope. And as you've just heard, the Jesuits are involved with the aliens.
Satellite in my eyes, like a diamond in the sky. How I wonder, satellite strung from the moon.